and also during the liturgy, but it is most of the time, unfortunately, we pray them inaudibly, but the priest asks on behalf of the people to grant us, or the clergy, as well as all the people, houses of prayer, houses of purity, and houses of blessing. Actually, it was a good theme that we borrowed from St. Bernard of the Holy Youth Church maybe about 11 years ago. They had the same theme. And it stuck in my mind all these years. And when we came to plan for this year retreat, we thought that we would bring it back because of the importance of if we want our families and our congregation and our church to be blessed, we have to ask this prayer from the Lord every day, maybe multiple times a day, and maybe we can think about this as one of our goals, at least for the next few days, to put in our minds as we conclude this year and start, God willing, the new year next week. So tonight we're very blessed to have Abuna Boules Baki. I'm sure he is not unfamiliar to all of you, because last year he came at the same time and blessed us the whole time. Unfortunately, this year, his church is also currently undergoing or starting their retreat as well. But he graciously agreed to come to us and open the retreat with us and spend most of the night with us. Then, God willing, starting from tomorrow or so, he will be with his family and with his church. So thank you, Abuna, again for sacrificing for the sake of our blessing, that we may grow in purity and pray for our blessing.
It's very important. Can we decrease the voice? Little bit.
Dial behind you, Mike.
Well, I can use the.
Here, we lower it.
Is this better?
Yeah. Oh, this is pretty good. It's actually
better. Better now? In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, God grace will speak about the. This very special prayer in the church, houses of prayers, houses of purity, and houses of blessings. Did you ever think of the theme or the sequence of those prayers? Why it is prayers, then purity, then blessing? Does it make a difference? Why it is not houses of blessings, houses of prayer, houses of purity, for
example? Because the prayer is the one that brings the blessings and the purity.
Yes, the prayer will bring purity, and the purity and the prayer will bring blessing. And God knows that we are searching also for a blessing. We are always, we want to be blessed, we want to have blessing in our families, we want to have blessing in our relationships, financial blessing, blessing with the kids, blessing in everything. So God knows this, that blessing is a key, but He is telling us the path. In order to reach really a life of blessing, you need to start with the life of prayer and then a life of purity. There are two types of people. This is I did this with the youth in one of the lessons. In the summer. So this is simply a glass cup. It has oil. This one doesn't have any oil, but has a piece of cotton inside. And this one, it should have a huge piece of cotton, but I replaced the cotton with a small, tiny, floating thing that is there. But simply, families and we are two groups. The group of people who are living are two groups. The first group that has the oil, and the second group that does not have the oil. I think this would be
Higher?
It's for.
Higher?
Little higher. This was the last one was very sensitive. This one is not that sensitive. Okay. You can tell me. So there are two groups. Group of people, simply the whole world is two groups. Group of people who has oil and people who doesn't have oil. There is no other options. People are, the Holy Spirit is dwelling in them and they have God inside of them, and people who doesn't have God inside of them, as simple as that. So when you try to let the cotton inside of the oil, it will stay, as you can see, for how long this will stay shining?
For a while.
For how long?
As long as
As long as there is an oil. If the oil decrease, then the chances of that there will be no light will be increasing. So how long this is going to last? There is no oil. Yeah, it will live for a while. But after a while it is already, I don't know if you can see it or not, it is already burnt. It's amazing the amount of oil, and the presence of the oil is the key for the people to shine and to let in the world. So first of all, know that there are people who has oil and people who doesn't have oil. There is no other options. The second, now it's already gone, it's completely burnt. So within the people who has the oil, there are two other categories. This is a lot of oil, and this people a little bit less oil. And here, just very, very, very tiny amount of oil. So those are non-believers, non-Christians. God is not in their life. But those are we as Christians. A person that is filled with oil, a person that having oil hanging in there, it's okay. And the oil is, almost there. We're okay. And here, very, very little amount of oil. And the more the oil is decreasing, the more the cotton is burnt. Have you heard about people telling you that I feel that I'm burnt out? Big time. There's a difference between burnt out when there is no oil, and there's a difference between burnt out when you are barely having oil. My point of what has this to do with houses of prayer? The more we are praying, the more we have oil. The more we are a family of prayer, the more our light will be shining to all the people. The more we will be peaceful, the more we will be calm, the more we will be source of comfort to the people who are around us. The more we are running out of oil, the less we are praying, the less we are taking communion, the less we are reading in the Bible, the less we are having a fruitful time to connect with God, the more we are away from those who are having oil and closer to those who are not having the oil. Because simply, after a while, you will find that this with very, very little amount of oil, the light will be quenched. Or will be put off and will be coming closer. So this is a Christian person, this is a non-believer. They are dressing the same, speaking the same language, thinking the same way, fighting on money, and involved in inappropriate relationships outside or inside wedlock, living an impure life, speaking the same, simply almost the same as, you cannot differentiate them between from between each other. But what is the difference? What is the difference between those two? One, this is burnt out. This is not burnt out, but there is no light in it.
One has hope.
One has hope. There is always hope. If you threw this piece of cotton and you added oil and you put another, if when, whenever we come closer to God, things will change. But I will tell you a story. The work of the Holy Spirit, the work of the Holy Spirit also is a, the oil is, are we filled with the Spirit or not? So the oil can be a representation of our, are we filled with the Holy Spirit or not? Or also a representation for the amount of spiritual deposit that we do in our life. Houses of prayer, are we praying on a personal level, on a family level, on a church level? And how deep is this type of prayer? I know that this is not our topic, but a major mistake to do is to get married. So you are, the light is turned off, you are going away, and you are getting married with someone who doesn't have a heart. And when you put those together, that's why the church is saying, yes, you cannot get married to someone who is a non-believer, because how come you will be one body with someone who doesn't have the Holy Spirit? They don't have even, they are not a good fit, because simply you are putting yourself, being one with someone that God is not at all in their life. So is it clear? So the more we pray, the more we have houses of prayer, the more the oil level is increasing, the more the peace, the gentleness, the love, the kindness is there, spreading all over the in our family and also outside of our families. So there is no communion between light and darkness. It cannot be one. So even with the kids, when they are having, they are picking friends, or they are making long, important decisions for themselves in their life. Whom you are going to pick, how you are going to make a decision in this. So, do you have any question about this? I know some people just came. This is simply. People are two types. I'm not going to repeat, but just highlights. People are two types. People are filled with oil, and people who don't have any oil. When we let this piece of cotton inside of this container, it got burned because it doesn't have oil. While here, have very, very little amount of oil, and it turned off. While here, it is just little oil hanging in there, and those are the three types of Christians. So this is a believer. This is a believer that is filled with the Holy Spirit, filled with the life of prayer. This is a believer that is hanging in there, and this is a believer, unfortunately, that did not lose the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit will dwell in the person till the last breath of life. There is a scary story, but I will tell you the story to understand this. There was a monk who was walking in the tombs, and he found a lady, and this lady was dressed in white, and she was doing this. She was putting her hand in one of the caskets, carrying a piece of cotton, and she's squeezing the piece of cotton like this, and continue to collect the piece of the cotton all over. And this abuna was wondering what's going on, who is this lady, what she is doing. And he realized, he asked her, and she was Saint Mary. And she was telling him, this is a body of a Christian guy who converted to Islam, and he is no longer a Christian. So the monk was telling him, what are you doing, Saint Mary? And she's telling him, I am taking the mayroon of my son. I am taking from him the mayroon of my son. Because the Holy Spirit dwells in us till the last breath of life. And God is not going to leave us, or the Holy Spirit will depart from us in any time of our life till the last breath. But the whole point is the Holy Spirit is lit. Is it working, hanging in there, or unfortunately we are not? You have any tissue? The wives will make it there. So the more we are filled with the Holy Spirit, the more this applies or shows in our relationships with our families, with our kids, with the spouses, the more we are shining and the more God is there. So they will see your righteous or good works and they will glorify God who is in heaven. The more we are the decreasing our prayer, we are not that praying, we are not that much involved in church, we are not reading the Bible, the more the level of the oil is decreasing. After the decrease of the level of the oil, we are hanging in there. Sometimes we are burnt out and we don't know what to do. And we don't know what to do in our life, because simply things has been in a very bad or a very tough situation. So houses of prayers. What is the biggest problem among today's students? Billy Graham asked the former Harvard president. Derek Bach, the president, replied. One word. Come on, prayer is not there, but. What is the difference between this one and this one? Just from the physical perspective.
Empty.
Empty. Thank you. It's emptiness. Emptiness is a very, very, very common thing right now, where you deal with people, you hang out with people, you go in a business activity or gathering or a birthday, and you feel that the people are speaking about nonsense. There is nothing that they are speaking about is things that are irrelevant, that you feel the emptiness from within. Though maybe they look great from outside, but there is a lot of emptiness inside. One of the famous psychoanalysts also described his clients, and he said the refugees from fast track who complain of feeling empty despite of fat bank accounts, of feeling unfulfilled while living life to the fullest. Have you opened the fridge before, and when you look in front of the fridge and you don't know what you want to eat? This happened to you? And you are standing in front of the and you keep wondering and you don't know what's there. Maybe I'm not speaking about it, this is emptiness, but sometimes you the feeling of I'm not satisfied, I need something more to satisfy me. What is this thing? I don't know. So also a famous writer said this, we are hollow men distracted from distraction by distraction. And the distraction is a very, very common problem in prayers. One of the biggest. So the devil is attacking us in the life of prayer in many, many ways, because if you list down the warfare against prayer is unbelievable. First, do not pray because I'm lazy or I'm busy. I don't have time, or when I have time I will pray, but I never get time. Or when you pray, you get distracted. Text, email, Facebook, WhatsApp, everything is ringing in the time of prayer. So first, do not pray. Second, if you pray, then get distracted. If you didn't get distracted, focus on when to finish, how to get it done. So I didn't pray in the beginning, or when I prayed, I got distracted. When I got distracted, if I didn't get this, I'm focusing, I'm hurrying up so as to get done with the prayer without feeling the presence of God. So if I didn't hurry up and I prayed, and so I bypassed or get over the first temptation not to pray, I prayed. Distraction, I'm focused. Going in depth, or reaching feeling connection with God. If this happened, the last the last step, okay, then let me have feel self-righteous. So I prayed the Salah, my wife didn't pray, he didn't pray, she didn't pray, I'm much better here. I feel self-righteous, and when I feel self-righteous, I'm more prideful because of my achievements of prayer. And the last temptation after all of this, so do not go to prayer or don't go to church. If you prayed, get distracted. If you get distracted, don't go in depth. If you went in depth and you finished your prayer, feel good about yourself and start attacking others. If you didn't, if you succeeded in all of this, sometimes a fight will happen or something that will, very, very common. People are fighting on Sundays. I don't know if you know this or not, but it's very, very common. Sundays, after taking communion, where all the attacks is happening. Because of the blessing that we got, and the devil is trying to take this blessing away from us. So a human being is a spirit, soul, and body. If you put the whole world, even if we own the whole world inside of us, will this satisfy the triangle? Will this fully satisfy the triangle? Are you there? We put the whole world inside of the triangle, which is a human being, the spirit, the body, and the soul. Will the whole, if the whole world is inside, even I'm more rich than Bill Gates. The highest rate of addiction and inappropriate lifestyle and major mistakes is happening with the people who are having it all. This is a fact. Because there is something that is missing. Even if I put the whole world inside of me, there are three empty corners of the triangle. What will fit completely a triangle? That's right. It's very simple. So a triangle will fit fully a triangle. That's why we are in the image of God, the Trinity, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and we will never be satisfied except when God is filling the void of everything. That's why it said, the Bible said, what shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world inside of him and he owns the whole world, but he lost himself. So God is only the way of our satisfaction. So we're going to speak about three things. First, what is prayer? Then we'll focus on the risk of not praying. Then this will be how to pray, practical things to do. Prayer is a bridge between us and God, and it is a relationship. You cannot say that I have a relationship with someone whom you don't talk to, you don't listen to, you don't meet, you don't spend time with. Even in long distance relationship, they are using FaceTime, you need an interaction. You cannot say that I am living a lot, I pray without connecting with God. Prayer simply is connection. It's connection with God. If I miss this connection, then there is something wrong. Then there's something is not happening. So, prayer is being in the presence of God, being with God. Also, it is the work of the heart. And many times when we pray, nobody is seeing anyone, nothing is being revealed, but it is just lifting up the heart in front of God. Do you recall somewhere in the Old Testament is a vivid picture of someone who is feeling or being in the presence of God? Very famous character in the Old Testament. Every time, before he's saying anything, he's saying, حي هو الرب الذي أنا واقف أمامه. Alive is the Lord that I am standing before him. Before saying anything. Alive is the Lord that I am standing before. He's speaking to the king and the king is wondering, what is this weird guy? Where is God that you are standing in front of? You know who is this? Very famous in the Old Testament, one of the most top three famous in the Old Testament. Elijah. Elijah had this in front of him. He felt the being in the presence of God all the time. If you heard about Amunah Michael Ibrahim, the departed, who was the father of confession of the Pope Shenouda, he used to make the sign of the cross before sin, before doing any email, official emails at that time. Before starting his job, he made the sign of the cross. Before reading any memo in the work, he is signing, making the sign of the cross. Definitely, he is praying. So people get really agitated, and they went to the office manager, and they complained against him. And the office manager pulled him in, and he told them, Mikhail Afendi, no more of this weird stuff that you are doing. We are here in business, and business is business, and stop doing this. So he told them, stop doing what? He told them, this sign of whatever. So he told them, okay, and he was very sad and upset, and he left. This office, the manager, the boss, had a huge renal colic at night. And he was almost dying from the pain of the renal colic. So he didn't know what to do. Then he found Saint Mary appearing to him. And he didn't know Saint Mary. And Saint Mary told him, why you have done this to Michael? Why you have done this to my servant? And he told her, whom are you talking about? She told him about Michael Afendi. This is Michael or Michael, Abuna Michael Ibrahim, before even being a priest. So she told him, Saint Mary is telling the boss, go call Michael Afendi and he will come and pray for you and you will be healed. Saint Mary is telling him to do this. They called Michael. In that time, he went in the middle of night, he prayed for him, he anointed him with oil and he got healed. Being in the presence of God is a key. And also is a way of living our life. Prayer also is a sign of love to God. You know, we'll assume that any story I would say Adam and Eve for the sake of that. So Adam and Eve, Adam proposed to Eve. Eve said yes. Eve was overseas and they're going to get engaged very soon. Eve's flight is delayed 7 hours. He got a message that she is delayed 7 hours and he was already in LAX. People are asking him, Habibi, Adam, go home, rest. There is no need to wait for Eve. She is late anyway, 7 hours. This is a long time. You can go and do whatever and return back when she's arrived. And he said, no, I'm not going to leave the airport. I'm staying at the airport. I'm waiting for Eve to come and nothing is going to change my mind. Fast forward 10 years, Adam and Eve got married. It happened that Eve also is traveling, and she also is going to the same place, and her flight is delayed, also 7 hours. And he received a text message from Eve, telling him, I'm sorry, I'm late, my flight is delayed for 7 hours. What Adam is doing? When you land, text me. If I am awake, I will come to pick you up. If not, call Uber and come quickly. What is happening? In the time of love, in the time where there was a lot of feelings and a lot of emotions, we had Eve was delayed and Adam was waiting 7 hours in the airport, there's no problem. And it was like 7 minutes for him. But what happened after marriage? We can ask Eve and Adam afterwards. But the whole point, when we love someone, we give time. When you love someone, you give him or her time. When there is no love, the time is decreasing. So our commitment, so prayer is a love to God, and in order to show this love, we need to have time. The prayer is sanctifying the time and make the person holy and make the place even holy. And it is a horror to the devils. Have you been to a tahuna in Egypt? Anyone knows what I'm talking about? The windmill in the middle of nowhere, in a very, very remote, the most ghetto area that you can think of in Egypt. You cannot even, you will be scared if you are just walking in the streets. And thousands of people are going where? To a place in the middle of nowhere, in a very ghetto area. What to do in there? It was the place where Pope Carlos was living for a long time. And the blessing and the miracles that is happening in this place, unbelievable. Why? Because there was a holy man, was a man of prayer, a man of God that lived in this place. And this place is being sanctified by his presence. So prayer even sanctified the place that we are living in. What do you think will be the risk of not praying? Sometimes we think that, it's like, pray, go to church, and fast, learn hymns, memorize Coptic, do tisbeha, do whatever. Serve in Sunday school, do something. Sometimes we put prayer in the rank of a regular thing that we are doing. Because prayer, maybe in our mind, is something regular also that we are doing. We don't value prayer as it should be. So what would be the risk of praying? It is sin not to pray for others. Do you know this? It is sin not to pray for others. Look to this verse. So what about not praying at all? Moreover, as for me, far be it from me that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for you. 1 Samuel chapter 12. It is a sin for me not to pray for others. And if it is a sin for Samuel is counting himself a sinner if he is not praying for others, then definitely praying for God is very, 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 very important. Pope Shenouda is saying, do you count your prayer as a prayer? If you are praying 2 minutes before you sleep, Our Father who art in heaven, before eating, before exams, and before a driving test or MCAT or SATR, you think that this is the prayer? Have you seen Bolt? You know what? You seen the fastest, Usain Bolt, the fastest man on earth? Do you know what I'm talking about? Whom I'm talking about? In the Olympics. Making the sign of the cross before starting the race. Is this is the prayer? Is this the essence of prayer? Is this is really where you connect with God? In our home, we try to say a song before eating. I don't know, it's an Arabic song. It's called Abled Din at Midday Din, before our hands. You put your hands and bless the food. So I start saying, we have 4 kids. The food is in front of the of them. Abledin at Midday Din. We barik et al khubzay shab'an albi. Already they are halfway with the food. So yes, it happens. But is this prayer? If because sometimes or many times, I'm praying before sleeping. Our Father who art in heaven, we are praying together for the family. You know, be with us, and glory be to God forever. Amen. And sometimes we are deceiving ourselves, thinking that this is prayer. And I'm praying before eating, and I'm praying before driving, and I'm praying. So Pope Shuga is saying, do you think that this is prayer? A prayer, a time that you stand in front of God and not getting anything out of it, this is not counted as a prayer. Pope Shuga is saying this. If you are in front of God and you are praying and you didn't get anything out of this prayer, don't count this as a prayer. How this will look like? How this prayer will look like? Our Father who art in heaven, a very quick prayer, a prayer that I do it while eating. No, it is completely different. So we'll speak about this. There is a huge risk for a lack of prayer. The risk of a lack of prayer, think of this. There is a risk on yourself, there is a risk on your spouse, there is a risk on your kids, there is a risk on your future, and risk also on the church. Think of those factors. How prayer will affect me emotionally. If I'm not praying, and think of this, I'm not, Adam and Eve are not praying. So how this lifestyle will affect Adam on a personal level, from the emotional level, from the physical, intellectual, spiritual, financial, and social. This is a question for you. How you will look like? You will be looking like the same. Nothing is different than all human beings. They are the same. I will ask you in a different way. Are you feeling burnt out? Are you feeling agitated easily? Are you feeling people are on your nerves? Are you feeling that you are losing your peace 200 times an hour? Are you feeling that you are snapping at people without even having any reason for doing this? Are you feeling that you don't have tolerance for your kids for nagging and nagging and nagging and nagging and you are done with it? Are you feeling jealousy? Comparing, they have upgraded this and they have got this home in this place and we did it and he upgraded her, Adam upgraded Eve's her car and they got a new house in this beach area and you're feeling anxious? Are you sleepless? Are you losing hope? Are you losing interest? Are you thinking negative thoughts of hurting yourself or hurting others? All of this are symptoms of a void or a man or a woman or a family that is not praying. It is crucial. The life of prayer is making the difference. I will give you an example. What you are praying for your kids? And what will be the most thing that you will be praying for your kids? How about protect them? Be with them at school. What else? Anything else? That they will be good deacons. They will make it to the famous school in the neighborhood, charter school that all the smart kids are in. What are you going to pray for? I'm confessing. I always thought that I was really praying for my kids till I read the book The Power of a Praying Parent. The Power of a Praying. Have you heard about this book? Anyone have read it? Raise your hand. Only one couple? Okay. The Power of a Praying Parent. It's a very, very simple idea of a very simple book. Actually, the lady that wrote the book was not intentionally even planning to write the book. She was praying for her kids by name. And she was praying to God to guide her in what prayer she will pray for every kid. Are you there? She is praying to God to reveal to her, okay, for the first kid, who, what I will pray for him or her, what they really need, what they really, God wants me to pray for them in what aspect. And she kept doing this with her friends. Then they had a group of families that they prayed for the kids. Then they started having this in the church. Then they started doing a full day of prayer just for the kids. Then people who were attending this were very, very much asking. For to repeat this, I will just share with you few things that this lady was praying for. Security and protection from harm. All of us are praying for this. Feeling loved and accepted by us in our family and also by their friends and kids around them. Establishing an eternal future, focusing on their eternity and their salvation. Are we praying for this? Honoring parent and resisting rebellion. This is a very common prayer, because they are rebelling and they are telling us, those who are praying, that God will break their personality so they will submit. Maintaining good and family relationship, attracting godly friends and role models in their life, developing hunger for the things that is of God, praying for being the person that God created, praying for following the truth and rejecting lies, praying for enjoying life and health and healing, praying for having motivation for a proper physical health, praying for instilling the desire to learn and to obey and to submit, praying for identifying God-given gifts and talents in them, praying for learning how to speak and gaining wisdom, praying for staying attracted in holiness, to holiness and purity and living a pure life, praying for the through the children's room and praying for enjoying freedom from fear, sound mind, joy of the Lord, inheritance of family bondage, avoiding alcohol and drug and addiction, rejecting sexual immorality, finding perfect spouse, living a free life, free of forgiveness, walking in repentance and living a life of repentance, breaking down ungodly strongholds, seeking wisdom and discernment, growing in faith. And I'm just giving you the titles of the chapters of the book. And I was thinking that I was praying for my kids. And I started going through the book. Oops, I didn't pray for this. Oops, and I didn't pray for this. And this, and this, and this, and this, and this. All of this needs what? Needs what? In order to do this, needs what?
Time.
If there is no time, there is no prayer. There is no time, there is no depth. Do you know what is the difference between deep sea fishing and pier fishing? Anyone is good at fishing? Is okay? None? So I say whatever I want to say. Okay. The pier fishing, you go in the pier, you throw the fishing rod, you get a small tiny little fish. You can play with it with the kids. And if you have a bucket full of water, you can keep the fish and then throw it afterwards. How long it take you from the parking lot to the end of the pier? 5 minutes. Deep sea fishing, have you heard about deep sea fishing? You go 5 a.m., you pack from the night before, you travel, then you go in the sea, sometimes almost 200 miles inside of the sea, couple of nights. And have you seen people on Facebook carrying this huge, big fish? This is deep sea fishing. This is not fishing on the pier. You cannot fish this type of fish in the pier. In order to have a big catch, in order to make a change, you need time and you need energy to go all the way in the depth. You cannot just have that catch when you are on the pier. It will never happen. It needs time, it needs depth. And also prayer needs time and needs depth to have this fruits of prayer in our life. But if it is a very quick to go drive through prayer, it doesn't work. It doesn't work with God. We need time. We need to give God time. We need to have patience. We need to have quiet time. We need to have the mindset. It is not quick. Ah, I prayed and it didn't happen. So, خلاص, I'm not praying anymore for this. No. There is a huge risk. So you will find yourself emotionally unfulfilled, angry, resenting, burned out, snapping at people physically, always tired, intellectually distracted, and the mind is clouded, spiritually disconnected, financially there is no barakah, there is no blessing. You know, in the book of Proverbs it said, Al-akhiz ugra ila kis manqub, the one who gets wages, and he put the wages in a bag that is hollow from the bottom. Just an empty a bag that has a big, huge hole. So you put the money, and the money is gone because there is no blessing. Simply, there is no blessing. Socially, the fights between people and anger and comparison and frustration, and I don't want to deal with this, with those are blacklisted, with those we don't want to deal with them, with those who are not going to invite them, with those. All of this is a reason of, one of the major reasons is lack of prayer. Also for your spouse, living, sleeping, angry, having fights, unforgiving. You know, there was a nice story, maybe I have said the story before. There was a very, very righteous old young man working as a teacher. And he had two friends of himself working also in the same school. We call them Adam and Eve, and they were married couple. So a day, this servant is going to his school, and Eve is slamming the door. Adam is very upset. They are very angry, they are very agitated. Then he knew there is something wrong going on. He went to Adam, and Adam told him, Eve. So he told him, okay. Then he went to Eve, and she told him, Adam. So he said, okay, can I come to you at night? We'll have dinner together. I'm inviting myself to your home. They told him, okay, I want to come to Adam. He went. They resolved the issues that was there. They prayed, they ate together, they prayed, and he told them, can you promise me one promise? So they told him, okay, what is this promise? And he told them, pray our Father who art in heaven together. Wow, it's very simple. Okay. But there is one condition. What is the condition? When you pray, forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Mean it. Mean it and apply it and live it in your life. So this means that you will never be going to sleep. You will never be going to sleep when you are angry or mad at each other. Because you will be praying together, and when you are praying together, you will ask for the forgiveness. And when you ask for the forgiveness, then you will forgive, then you will reconcile, then things, peace will be restored. Are you there? 3 months later, the servant is seeing Adam and Eve, and they are the same, and he is checking on Adam, he is telling him any news. Nothing is changing. Eve, the same. So the servant was wondering, but I haven't seen you all agitated or angry like the last time that I saw you. You look much peaceful. He told him, yes, all of what we have because of the promise that we promised. Every day we have the same fights. The same issues, the same struggles, the same problems. But we found that the prayer with the whole heart, with a clear conscience in front of God at the end of the day, brought us together. We reconciled before standing in front of God. And that's why we apply, do not let the sun set on your anger. So here, the role of the prayer that brings the spouse and restore the peace in the home is a key. is a key. Family pray together, stay together. Family pray together, stay together. I think I have shown you this before, I'm not sure. But if you are moving and you're making a decision of moving, the CTM is, the crime rate is 1 in 3. Every 3 people in this city, one of them will be robbed or killed or exposed to crime. CTC, 1 in 2. Every 2 families or every 2 people, one person will be exposed to crime. City, number 3, every 100 families, or I'm sorry, every 100 people, one person will be exposed to crime. The city P and C, every 1100 person, one will be exposed to crime. Which city will move to? Which one?
P and C.
P and C, but it will be expensive. You cannot get, in C you will get a mansion. And in P and C you will get a condo. But you can weigh the things, which one you will go based on the safety and the security where you are going to live. Those are not cities. It is the rate of divorce. M, city M is nationwide. Every 3 families, one family is divorcing. C in California. Every 2 families, one family is divorcing. There is even more worse news about California. In Southern California, we have a Coptic young lady did a PhD study. Her PhD thesis was about the Coptic community, and she was doing research also on Orange County. And the rate of divorce in Orange County, every 3 family, 2 family is divorcing. Scary. So what is the rate of divorce for family pray together? Every 100 family, one family is divorcing. So what is P and C? What?
Praying in California.
Praying in California.
Praying in communion. Prayer in communion.
Rate of divorce, family praying daily and going to church weekly together. 1 in 1100 families. It is sad for me as a priest to convince the congregation that prayer is making your life better. It is good for you to pray. For me, it doesn't look, at least from my perspective, I feel. Little bit weird about this approach, but in the end, if you really are worried about your family and the kids and their decisions in their life, simply live a life of prayer in home, on a personal level, as a family level, in church level. Pray on a daily basis, go to church weekly, take communion together, and before taking communion, reconcile. You will stay together. So, there is a huge risk for us if we are not praying. There is a huge risk for us if we are not praying. Prayer will make a man cease from sin, as sin will entice a man to cease from prayer. Prayer is like, when we stop praying, someone else said, for a Christian, prayerlessness is identical to backsliding. When you stop praying, you stop feeling the presence of God. When you stop feeling the presence of God, if you were fasting Wednesday or Friday, you start, what a Wednesday, what a Friday, nobody is fasting, those fast, this is sad. You start eating fitari food. Then you start making your birthdays, the birthdays of the kids on Wednesday and Friday, because you forgot that there is Wednesday and Friday as a fasting. Then you start, you never said a bad word about any person, you find yourself saying a lot of bad words and gossiping and backbiting people. You used to give tithe, you stopped giving tithe, and we are heading in a slippery slope. And this is not the situation of us only, but look to Adam and Eve, real Adam and Eve. When they were in the presence of God, they stayed in the presence of God and they didn't sin. When Adam separated from Eve and Eve was alone, and the conversation started between Eve and the serpent, if Eve was praying, would she have been falling in that temptation if she was praying? Because praying is what? Connection with God. Now if the Satan or the serpent is telling her, if you is it true that he told you to do this? She will go to God and tell him, okay, is it true that you did this? God will assure her, or Adam with her will assure her, and they will speak with God, and she will return back to the serpent and say, no, no, this is a lie, this is not going to happen. When you stop praying, everything else is falling apart. When you stop praying, everything else is falling apart. And you think of the things that you never thought of doing ever, ever, ever. After a while of not praying, give it a year or two, you will find yourself doing the things that you would never think that you have, you can go and do this type of stuff. Why? This is a lack of prayer. There was a very famous businessman. He's very, very rich. He went to get a fridge. And he went to get the fridge. The fridge was maybe $10,000. He put it in his very new, nice home. He was very happy. He likes drinking coffee in the morning and having milk with the coffee and having his own set of stuff that he takes breakfast with. He brought everything 2 days before, and he knew that people are coming, and he's inviting people, and the new fridge, everything is working fine. And in the morning he woke up, he opened the fridge, the $10,000 fridge. The milk smells bad, the food is rotten, and things looks really unclean, and he was very, very upset. He kept looking to the fridge. This is a new fridge. What's going on? What's going on? He called the customer service, started getting and having a fight with them. And the guy, he told him, there is light in the fridge. He told him, man, there is no light. So he told him, can you check on the connection of the fridge? He told him, okay. He looked back in the fridge. The fridge is not connected. If we are not connected as the fridge, we are simply useless. This $10,000 fridge is useless, is of no value, because it didn't do anything. It is not connected. If we are not connected with God through prayer, and our homes are not connected with God through prayers, then whatever we are doing is useless. Believe me, it will be useless. In the end, it will be useless. What will be the benefit of anything that we do if God is not there? Pour out your heart like a water before the face of the Lord. Lift your hands towards Him for the life of your young children. Lift your hands towards Him for the life of your young children. Do you know, when you pour out your heart like a water, then you are pouring everything in your heart. You are putting all your feelings, all your emotions, all the things, the thoughts, all the fears, all the things that is worrying you, everything in this prayer. And here, when you give it in the hands of God and lift your hands towards Him for the life of your young children. This story happened with Abuna Matta al-Miskin, or Abuna Matthew the Poor, in 1970s. Very old story, very famous story. Maybe some of you have known about it. A lady is going to Abuna Matta telling him, my daughter is lost. She's dressing inappropriately, she's drinking, she's sleeping over, I don't know where she is, and she's partying. And this was a lifestyle in Egypt at that time too. What shall I do? What shall I do? What shall I do? So Abuna told her, are you praying? She told him, sometimes. Are you going to church? Not that much. Are you reading the Bible? No. Are you having a father of confession? Yeah, I have a father of confession, but the last time I confessed was long time back. But I'm not asking you, Aguna, about myself. I'm telling you about the problem with my daughter. My daughter is having the problem. So Aguna told her, I know that you're 47, but I'm asking you about yourself. So she told him, it has nothing to do with me. It is her, she is the problem. So Aguna told her, I have a solution for you. But it means that you promise me that you will do whatever I tell you. She told him, I will promise you. Number one, this solution for 6 weeks. The duration of the solution, 6 weeks. Number two, first thing to do, not to talk to your daughter at all. What? Don't talk to her at all. Not out of animosity or hatred. No, you respect her, you smile, you give her the things that she is, or you take care of her stuff that her laundry or her food or whatever, but you don't talk to her at all. So they say, okay. Number two, go to your father of confession and live a life of repentance. Go to liturgy every week. Start praying psalms and reading the Bible on a daily basis and pray psalms for your daughter. You will do this for how long? 6 weeks. First week passed. Expect what was happening when the mom was talking to the daughter, when she is dressing inappropriately and doing all of this sins. What is happening? Where are you going? Why are you late? Whom you are with? Fights after arguments, endless. So this whole drama stopped. Then peace is technically home. The mom started living a life of repentance, changing her life, living with God, reading the Bible, going to church, praying for her daughter. After 3 weeks, the daughter came in the home and she was knocking on the door of her mom, and her mom didn't open forcefully, and she found her mom kneeling on the floor, holding fast to a cross, and she was praying. And she overheard her from outside, and she told her, Mom, I want this life. I want this life. The problem is, we think that the problem is in the kids, or the problem is in my spouse, or the problem is in the situations that we are in. But the problem is lack of prayer, lack of commitment to God. One of the youth said this, wrote this, but most importantly, I had lost my joy and peace. He was speaking about that he's not feeling himself before, as before, and he's feeling a lot of things weird. He said, I lost my joy and peace. I remember calling my mother one night, explaining my situation, asking her to pray for me, and she responded by telling me that God had brought me to this place for a reason, and that he was trying to get my attention. He was going through a very, very hard time in his life. And the following day when I opened the word, I was stunned by the scripture. Matthew 6:33. Seek first the kingdom of heaven, of God, and his righteousness, and all of these things shall be added to you. I had heard it so many times before, but never realized the profound simplicity of this passage. I had become so sidetracked by my own personal challenges that I was constantly asking God to make something happen in my life rather than truly seeking the Spirit of God to empower my life. It was at that point that I fell on my face before the Lord with no longer agenda than to seek Him. We are distracted with a lot of stuff in our life, and many times we are asking, oh, why it is not working in this? Why this is not happening? Why this is not getting, not happening in my life? Or why this problem is there? Or why are I'm not feeling any blessing in my life? Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And if I truly seek God, the kingdom of God, seek the kingdom of God and His righteousness, then prayer will be a pillar in my life. It will not be a check mark. I pray. No, 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 no. will be a pillar in my life. When we don't pray, when we pray, we are humbling ourselves before God and saying, I need your presence and your power, Lord. I cannot do this without you. When we don't pray, it is like saying we have no need of anything outside of ourselves. Again, when I don't pray, I say, as if it is like saying we have no need of anything outside of ourselves. I will tell you a personal confession. When I came to the US, I had Canadian driving license, Bahrain driving license, Egyptian driving license, and Emirates driving license. And they told me, you are going to go to the DMV to check in whatever, they will transfer the license for you. So I said, I went to the DMV, and they have the full driving license, 1, 2, 3, 4. Told her, hey, transfer whatever you want to. I mean, just give me the California driving license, I don't have time. So she told me, thank you, sir, for being there and your patience with us. Unfortunately, any of those driving licenses don't go to work out. Just a very tiny little test you kick, then driving test behind the wheels, then you will get the driving license and definitely will pass. That's no big deal. Just a matter of time. Okay, get me a test. Sorry, I need to get this done. So I took the written test, I passed the written test. Then I took the behind the wheel test. If this is the DMV, and I'm just going outside of the DMV, she didn't even tell me anything in the test. She told me, make a right turn. Then I did a right turn. And she told me, no, you turn and back to the DMV. Now I knew that I failed. Now, when you ask them when you are in the driving test, they don't say anything because you might be angry or something or do something. And obviously, you don't know how to drive. So no communication in the car. And I kept that. Just gave me the poker face. No communication. Till I arrived to the DMV, and she went outside and she told me, ah. When I told you make a right turn, there was a bike lane. So assume that there is someone who is riding a bike in this lane, and you just cross the lane, and if there was a person who is riding a bike, then this person is dead anyway. But I told her, okay. The second time I went to the driving test, I said, no, I will put the driving test in the day that I'm praying a liturgy in. And forget about the 4 driving licenses that I took. And I asked someone in the neighborhood who knows the driving rule, and I stayed with them 2 hours. And I prayed for it, and I said, you know what, I need you, Lord, because you are pretty much handicapped, you cannot do anything. And I, after all this driving license, I didn't have an international license, so I cannot drive. Liturgy day, I prayed diligently for the driving test. I asked God, I asked people, I did my homework, and I humbled myself, and when I humbled myself, I passed. But in order to think, I don't need to pray for this. This means that you master it and you are you don't need God in your life. And it is very scary. And this is meekness or pride. When I tell God, I don't need you in my life, this is pride. And God resists the pride and give grace to those who are humble. So it was a very strong message between me and God in this time. And I realize, you know, even if you master it, even if you are the most pro in this, if you have done this 200,000 times, pray before it and God will be with you and you will get blessed by the presence of God in your, whatever is the thing that you do. Praying parent or a perfect parent, what do you think? In order to raise our kids the way, the right way, we need a perfect parent or a praying parent? Both? Don't you think that there will be a perfect parent? Definitely not. speak about it. We have a rule at home, no throwing. Okay? No throwing, no throwing, no throwing, no throwing. Okay. And once Manel was rushing, I don't know what she's in the car, and she forgot her jacket. Anyway, so I threw the jacket for her from the second floor. And that was it. Everything is different. I put the rule, I break the rule, take the consequence. The kids, they don't need a perfect parent because there is no perfect parent. Simply, there is no perfect parent. But they need a parent who is praying for them, a prayerful parent. When things go wrong in our children's life, we blame ourselves. That, oh, I didn't do this, and I did the wrong decision. I should have done this more. I should have invested this more. I should have made this right. We blame ourselves and we beat ourselves up for not being perfect parents. But it is not being a perfect parent that makes the difference in the child's life, because there is no perfect parents. None of us are perfect. So how can we be a perfect parent? Being a praying parent that makes the difference, and that is something we all can be. We need to be putting God in our prayers, that He will guide, He will protect. And when we humble ourselves, I remember a 17-year-old boy coming extremely, extremely, extremely bitter and mad and angry. And he told me this thing that I cannot forget. For the past 17 years, my mom never said sorry. She's always right. And the amount of bitterness that he had was unbelievable. Because she's perfect. I don't do mistakes. And he gave me a list of issues. Sometimes the ones, they were driving and they were passing by a store, and he knew this store from his friends or whatever. And he said the name of the store right. So we told him, no, this is not the right name of the store. The store is spelled this way. So the store was a little bit far off. When they went closer to the store, he pointed to the name of the store, it is as he said. And she told him, you don't understand anything. And this is their life for 17 years. I am perfect mom. I don't do sins. I don't do mistakes. I know everything. This is not what the kids are in need of. The kids are in need of someone who's humble. Who say, yeah, I have my shortcomings. I have my problems. I have my issues. And I go. And I am being honest and I fix it. It is being a praying parent that makes the difference, and that is something we can all be. Kids, they don't need a perfect parent. They need a prayer parent, a praying parent. So how to pray? I will give you only one slide. In prayer, the life of prayer, all the fathers of the church, all the fathers, without an exclusion, they set these steps of prayer. First, force yourself, because in many times you will not be feeling, I like prayer, I want to attend the liturgy, I long for staying with God in quiet time. Very, 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 very rarely that this will happen in the beginning. Very rarely. So first, I didn't ask you to memorize anything. Now, time to memorize, okay? First is
force.
Force yourself, not your spouse. Very clear. Not your kids. Force yourself. Number two, this will be habit. Number three, you will enjoy it. And number four, being a prayer, but I give myself to prayer, as it says in Psalm 109, that we will live a life of prayer. As David said, I am a prayer. Amma ana fa salam. So So number one, force yourself. Number two, it will be a habit. Number three, you will enjoy it. Number four, your life will be a life of prayer. But the trick is, when I have time, I will pray, you will never have time. When I am free, I will pray, you will never be free. When I finish the movie, I will pray, you will be sleeping before the movie will end. It happens 100 times every day with everyone in our life. It needs that I will force myself. You know what? Put it on your calendar as a reminder. In the morning, I will not go outside of my room. I will not touch my phone. One of the a couple of 10 years back, when you wake up, there is no cell phone. There is no one who talk to you. There is nothing on Facebook. There is nothing there. Just much easy. You go do your prayer, read the Bible, and start your day. What is the first thing that you do after you wake up? And now this is the new God in our life that we greet. Can you go to your work without your phone? Can anyone do this? You'll return back, even if you're going to be late, even if this is going to be deducted from your salary, you'll go back to get your phone. So, Pope Shenouda was saying, the first person to talk to in the beginning of the day should be God. Whatever is around you, even if they are calling you and waking you up, just don't reply, make the sign of the cross, and even tell God, good morning, bless my day. How long is it going to take? But the first person that you greet and the first person that you open your eyes on should be God at the beginning of the day. So force, habit, enjoy, and so this is the slide, this is the last slide. Force is forcing oneself, simply pushing myself outside of my comfort zone, because my comfort zone is to be lazy, my comfort zone is not to pray, my comfort zone is to go to the beach on Sunday, my comfort zone is to watch a movie, my comfort zone is something has nothing to do with prayer. I need to force myself. I need to put it in my calendar, I need to put it in my agenda, on my reminder, and tell myself, even start with 5 minutes of prayer. There was a real life story about a monk who went to his, in the current church, maybe a couple of, maybe 20 years back or something. A monk went to his father of confession and he told him, forget about Agbaya. No. Psalms and Mazamir and Agbaya, no, forget about this, I cannot do it. So his father of confession told him, okay, can you pray one psalm? Do you know that in the monastery they pray the seven prayers twice? On a personal level and in the church level. That's why they are praying fast in the church. Because they already prayed it. So in order to pray seven prayers two times, and he is not into it, wow, how are we going to survive? And his father said, can you pray one psalm? He told him, only one psalm in the day? He told him, yes. After a couple of weeks, he went to him and he told him, can I add more? He told him, one psalm. After 3 years, he memorized the 150 psalms. After 3 years, he memorized the 150 psalms. Just take baby steps. I'm not saying force yourself that you are going to pray for. Just force yourself for a few minutes in front of God. But take this few minutes undivided attention without any distraction. And give it to God. And tell him, give me that I will stand in front of you in the beginning of the day and in the end of the day. It will make a huge difference. Once I had a debate with one of the youth, and we had a deal. Told them, okay, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, don't pray. You start the day and you just rush throughout the day and don't pray. Tuesday and Thursday, pray with the Agbaya for 10 minutes. And just tell me, after 2 weeks, how this is going to look like. How the Tuesday and Thursday will look like. They came with a big smile and they knew. The days that you start with a prayer is a completely different day. The day that you start with a prayer is a completely different day. Completely different. In priesthood, before priesthood, completely different day. Just you feel the presence of God, you are more calm, you are more peaceful, you are smiling, you feel the presence of God, You're less agitated, less irritated. You're a different person. So number one, for the force F, for forcing oneself. Number O is obligation of love. Remember that prayer is an obligation of love. It is not I'm forcing something on me that I will be better or I will have a higher rank when between my family members or I will be something that I will get more awards or more trophies. It is an obligation of love. You remember Adam and Eve when they were in the engagement time and when they were married? It was the same date in the flight, and the amount of love will show us, will give us a chance, or will put us in more, with more commitment to it. There is Saint Macarius said this about prayer. Saint Macarius means by true prayer, undistracted, collected, deep prayer that occurs when the mind stands unswervingly before God without distraction. As the mind begins to stand firmly before God, it discovers such sweetness that it wishes to remain in true prayer forever, desiring nothing more. Undistracted, collected, deep prayer that occurs when the mind stands unswervingly before God. You stand without getting distracted, and there will be a huge amount of attacks. Ah, I forgot this from Costco. Ah, I didn't do this. Someone called me 15 days back, and I need to reply, and the email, and about me. I don't know how to translate this. Forget it. If you started not being aware that you are entering in the path that really the devil is distracted so and disturbed because you are coming closer to God. So what he will do is just distract you as much as he can. So undistracted, collected, deep prayer. How many times you go to church and you enter outside of the church and you attended the whole liturgy and you feel nothing? Oh, Daddy, we prayed this prayer. Even the liturgy is not changing. Very nice prayer that you can pray even if you have been the most bored person on earth. Before entering the church door, tell God, give me the spirit of prayer. Give me Give me to feel your presence. A guy complained to Pope Shenouda and told him, I have attended hundreds of liturgies and I'm getting nothing. I'm getting nothing. It seems that it's not working. Pope Shenouda told him, if you benefited from 5% only of the liturgy, you will change. If you focused on 5% only of the letters, you change. But the whole point is we are distracted. How many times the youth now, even adults, are on text and on Facebook, in the church during the liturgy? Many times. The whole point is because the temptation or the devil knows that we have strength, we have power, we have connection with God, that's why he's attacking us in this. We go back to the number one, force yourself. Number two, it is an obligation of love. The more I love God, the more I give him time. Number three, are in the fourth rule of prayer. There should be a system of prayer, and go to your father of confession and take that even those few things that I can do. Maybe I will pray 5 minutes in the morning. What shall I pray? What shall I do? Ask in details. And be honest and faithful in this little details, because this is really how you will build the huge structure of prayer in your life with your family as well. There should be a rule of prayer. Saint Macarius said, if the greatest practitioners of prayers, Saint Macarius had 50,000 monks below him. He's saying this. The greatest practitioner of prayers, they have a rule of prayers. So how come we, the beginners, don't have a rule of prayer? Don't have a system for prayer? We're speaking about the pro. Go and check the life of Michael Phelps before the Olympics. You know, Michael first. Go and check his lifestyle. Go and check his lifestyle. He doesn't have life. He's doing only one thing, two things, actually three things. Swimming, eating, sleeping, nothing. Sleeping for 8 hours, sleeping for overnight, swimming for 8 hours, swimming overnight, going to the gym. He has no life. But that's why he is, on her, the achievement that he has done in the history, in the Olympics, unmatched in all the history of the human beings. But he had a system. You cannot do it. One of the girls that won maybe 6 or 7 medals in the Olympics, she had a picture with Michael Phelps when she was maybe 10 years old or something. She was doing that good, and she's 16, 17 years old now. I don't remember her name. And the guy was interviewing her on the TV, was telling her what you are going to do. And she said, now I can have one slice of pizza. This is what she said. Now I can have one slice of pizza. Discipline. Now why we don't have discipline in our spiritual life? Simply because we are not valuing the importance of this. So, F4. Did I tell you about the options in the COVID? There is escape. You press escape, then F5. Have you heard a lot? Shift F5. Do you know this? If you press escape, then shift F5, what happens? You go to what?
To the first slide.
So if we, Marisha won't absorb me. If you didn't memorize this slide, I will absorb me. And escape, you know, okay. I showed you. You go back to the first slide. It's very easy. I think that you will focus. So F4, forcing oneself. O4,
obligation
of love. Now you are okay. R4, rule of prayer. And the key of the rule of prayer is your father of confession. Don't set a rule of prayer, I will do this and I will do that. Go. Because the father of confession will guide you and is guided by the Holy Spirit to give you really what you need to do. Rule of prayer, number C is set, keep the prayer as a central focus of your life. And be aware that if I stop prayer, the coldness of the heart because of the abundance of sin, the love of many will grow cold. Why people, their love to God is growing cold because they stop praying. There is no other thing that stop or prevent us from getting in communion with God other than prayer. Do you like stories? I was driving on the freeway, phone call, unknown number. Hello, hi, Abuna, how are you doing? Hi, Habibi, yeah. I am so-and-so from the church, so-and-so, and I know that this guy who proposed to me, or seriously dating, you are his father of confession. So I told her, okay. But before you asking me anything, he is confessing to me, but this doesn't mean that I want to reveal anything of his confessions. Are we okay? Yes, we're okay. Abuna, I have a question for you. He is not praying. So I told her, this is a question or a statement? She told me, no, he told me this. He is not praying. Okay. So what is the problem? And my father of confession always told me this. She doesn't speak English. She doesn't speak Arabic at all, but she told me this statement in Arabic. إن رأيت إنسان لا يحب الصلاة أعرف أن ليس فيه شيء صالح البتة. If you see someone who does not love prayer, know that this person does not have anything good in himself. Many of Ramis Sulayani said, Isaac the Syrian. I pulled over and the Syrian, this is serious. I don't know. You are who? Which church? Who's your father of confession? Okay. What are you talking about? The guy that was seen is deleted. Ah, okay. So you are telling me that he is not praying? And your father of confession always told you this. If you see a man that is not does not love prayer, know that this person will not have anything good from himself. Saint Isaac the Syrian. So he's not praying, and your father of confession is telling you this. And what does this mean to you? She told me, I know. What does it mean to me? I will break up with you. And she broke up with that. And she was such a righteous woman. But look what she is searching for. And I knew afterwards, I met her afterwards, she's a top-notch in her career. Very smart, very successful, making a lot of. But all what she cared for is this statement of her father of confession. Because if you lose prayer, you lose everything. You lose everything. It is the central focus of our life. Alas, Father, it almost. F, force yourself. No. Focus with me. You are almost there. Almost there. F, force yourself. O, obligation of God. R, rule of prayer. C, the central focus of life and the coldness at the source of the absence of prayer will lead to that my heart will grow cold from God. And the last, the essence of prayer. What is simply the essence of prayer? The essence of prayer is to be in the presence of God. Feeling the presence of God. Feeling that God is with you. Feeling that, you know what? I don't know, if you have you, I don't know, have you ever had $10,000 cash in your pocket? Think of it, you have $10,000 cash in your pocket and you are going to In-N-Out to buy a sandwich. You even go to Ritz-Carlton. That's not going, that the one night isn't going to cost you that much. You feel, you know, what do you feel? You feel what? Other than feeling rich, feel secure. You feel that you have something that you can count on if something wrong is happening, that you can resort back to this. It is the same feeling when you feel the presence of God in your life. You feel secure. You feel that there's something different. The essence of prayer is feeling or being in the presence of God. And I will end with a story, and there was a monk that I will call him Mr. Right. Prayer, reading the Bible, okay. Attending midnight prayers, perfect. Liturgy, perfect. Work, perfect. Everything, perfect. And after he does everything by the book, just the devil appeared to him and started fighting him and was almost beating him to death. And in the end of this very, very scary experience, he called God and he said, "Oh Lord, have mercy upon me." And on the spot, Christ appeared, cast out the demon, and started speaking with him. And he was very, very upset from God. And he told him, "You know what? I have done everything right. I have everything, but I did it right. Why you have forsaken me? Why you are not there for me?" So God told him, "When you ask me, I came." He told him, "Yes." So he told him, ask me all the time. "When you ask about my name, did I come? I come right away." So he told him, "Call upon me all the time," which is Jesus' prayer, "Oh my Lord, Jesus Christ, have mercy upon me." Oh my Lord, Jesus Christ, have the salat sahmiya, salat yasua. This is how to apply praying unceasing. So the remembrance of the name of God, you feel the presence of God. And when you feed the presence of God, this is simply the whole essence of prayer. The essence of prayer is to feed the presence of God. And when you feed the presence of God, you will find yourself taking heed more or being cautious more with things that will distract you or things that will stop you or prevent you from being with God or lead you to astray. Who of you want to be joyful all the time? There is a difference between joy and happiness. Do you know the difference? Anyone? What is the difference between joy and happiness? Happiness needs something to happen, to be happy. Something to happen, to be happy. Win a lottery, get a great scholarship, a great job, something to happen, to be happy. So if this something that is happening is not happening, what you will be? Miserable. But joy is different than happiness. Joy is fruit of the Spirit. Joy is, and I will see you, and you will have joy, and no one can take this joy from you. The Lord is telling the disciples. So joy cannot be taken away from you, and it is non-dependent or independent on happening things that is happening outside. So who wants to be always joyful? Only one? There is conditions. The Bible gave us a condition. If you want to be always joyful, two things. Always pray, always give thanks. And those are the three verses or the three times that the Bible said always. It never said صلوا كل حين اشكروا على كل شيء افرحوا كل حين صلوا افرحوا كل حين. Rejoice always, and I tell you rejoice. Pray unceasingly and pray always, and in everything give thanks. The three things that is being mentioned in the whole Bible to do it all the time is those. Have joy all the time? But yes, great, I hope to have joy all the time. Then the two things, pray always and give thanks always, and glory be to God forever and ever. I don't think that you have any questions.
Pray for us.
Pray for us. You pray for me. The prayer of the kids, and you realize this, that the prayer of the kids are very, 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 very powerful. And don't underestimate the prayer of your kids for you. Don't ever underestimate it. They are very powerful.
Thank you, gentlemen. Like I said, we ask Aguna to pray for us that we can pray, and that our kids can pray. Thank you, Buddha, for the time, and we hope that we can try to apply all that Buddha encouraged us to do. We want to pray, to force ourselves until it becomes a habit to rejoice in it, and to finally to be praying. Thank you, Buddha. God willing, I will pray now, and then we'll eat, and I believe it's in